Well, hi, everybody, and thanks for joining us for another edition of the Lunch and Learn. My name is Joe Vincent. I'm from the Human Resources Department. Joining me today, as always, is my partner in crime, Kit Avanzado.
Hello, everyone.
And if that isn't a fun name to say, I don't know what is.
It's a pretty fun name.
It's fun.
I do it every day at 10 o'clock in the morning.
Do you really?
By clockwork.
That's
Kit
weird.
Kit Avanzado.
We're going to address those issues later. But for right now, we got a show to do, and you're gonna notice very quickly. You may have an inclination where you think, sort of feels to me like they're spinning off the rails, and that's possible. But Brian is here. For those of you that are nervous, he's not sitting at the desk, and that's a cause for concern for those of you that like law and order and process and things. But he's back there. He even has a whiteboard, I saw at one point.
He does.
Which means he can write messages, but we don't have to listen to them. It's going to create a great dynamic for today's show. So we got a lot of things that actually we're looking forward to covering with you. October is Cybersecurity Month, so we got a deal coming up about that later. Kit and I got in the car together with a camera. It was a disaster.
It was fun.
I mean, from a production standpoint, I feel like it was a disaster. But we're going to look at some of that because it was fun. We enjoyed it. We think you will too. We got another Get to Know with Kit and Joe segment this week, I think.
That's right.
Yeah, we do. I don't even know who it is.
Probably a good thing that we don't know. So people have to stay tuned in order to know.
See, a little incentive. You are a valuable part of this team.
I am.
And finally, in studio and joining us via Zoom today, we got Donna Brown. She is the Assistant Vice President of Human Resources. That's Donna.
Hello.
Hi, Donna. Over across the table from me, sitting next to Kit, is Mary Carter. She's the Director of Payroll. And live via Zoom, with the fanciest background I ever did see, is Tonya Fitch. She's the Director of Human Resources. Donna and Tonya, as sort of HR point people function in similar capacities in Kirksville and in Mesa, right? And so I think we're going to be talking about the Fair Labor Standards Act today, FLSA. We were having fun with the acronym earlier, but it's definitely Fair Labor Standards Act. And talking about some issues that probably a lot of people at the university are concerned with, right?
Yeah. Absolutely, and you know that's the thing too. This being the week to where we officially kind of launched the new system, it's there's been a lot of questions. So both interdepartmentally and you know just across the campus, it's been fun in a sense. So I guess one of the questions we have to ask first to start off is, what exactly is FLSA?
So, thank you for asking, Kit.
Jumping right into it. Here we go, Tonya.
The Fair Labor Standards Act actually originated back in 1938. Franklin Roosevelt was the president at that time, so I don't think we have any employees that started back then, but you never know.
We might.
AP still was alive. The school was established, so that's good. It established about five different criteria for the work week. It established a 40-hour work week. It established a national minimum wage. It established time and a half for overtime in certain jobs. It prohibited employment of minors, and it affected over 700,000 workers back in 1938.
Wow.
1938.
That's a long time
ago. Before 1938, nobody had to pay over, you couldn't earn overtime for anything. Is that right?
That's correct.
So you could be like basically 7 years old, working 80 hours a week, and that was totally legal.
Wow.
If you think about their history at that time, we're coming out of the Depression and the Industrial Revolution, so.
Cool. Wow.
So let me ask you again, Tonya, why should we care about FLSA? What's the relevance to us rather?
Well, I think what's relevant is all the changes that have happened over the years. It's not just an act that's changed with the Obama administration, but it's changed about every 7 to 10 years, part of it, whether it defines the work more, whether it defines what an exemption is, or whether it sets the minimum standards for your salary threshold. And that's what changed in May of 2016, is the salary threshold changed from 23,000 up to 47,000.
So going back, like this is the same law that tells us like what a minimum wage, like what a federal minimum wage has to be paid. Is that right?
That's correct.
Oh, I had a burp just then.
Perfect timing.
Terrible timing. Don't breathe for a second. It's going to be awful.
I'm out.
So we got overtime. We got minimum wage. So it does affect people here. Like we care about it because it sort of sets the standards for a lot of you know, how we work here or what the conditions are that we work under, right?
Yeah, maybe
that's
just to clarify a little bit, the law didn't change May of 16, but that's when they made the recommendations for the changes that will be effective December 1st of 2016.
Okay. So it's changed a lot, every 7 to 10 years or so, and there's new ones coming. Is that what we're saying?
Yeah, and there's also this change that's going to, as Donna said, that's coming as of December 1st. It's the first time that they've put an inflationary change to it every 3 years. So every 3 years, the salary threshold is actually going to move and keep up with the time, so they don't have to all of a sudden double it in one instance. So there's been some regulation, some buzz, and a bill that was passed in Congress, but more than likely, possibly the president will veto it because this is something he wants to get through in his administration, meaning President Obama.
Right. You know, and speaking of changes, change is a big word, and I think one of the bigger changes you mentioned is that hike in that salary. So you mentioned it was roughly around $23,000, I believe, and then all the way up to around $47,000, $48,000. Can you talk a little bit about that and how it's going to affect people here at ATSU? I mean, I think a lot of people are kind of almost panicked in a sense. So I guess give some clarification on that.
Yeah, and while you're answering, I'm wondering, why did it hike so much, first of all?
Yeah.
That seems like a huge jump. And it seems like it's happening fairly quickly, right? Did it take you guys by surprise?
No, not really. We've heard from our associations, the Society of Human Resource Management, as well as CUPA, which is the College and University Professional Associations. This has been within our discussion areas for about 2 years that this was going to change. When the original legislation and things went through, they thought it would be a 60-day implementation, and they moved it out to 6 months, which is December 1st. And we've been talking about it since actually 2013. And some jobs through attrition, we've been filling on a non-exempt basis because they don't meet the duties test. So there's two components to this. It's just not based on salary. It's also based on what are the duties of the job. So we're looking at that at AT still across the board. And we've been working on that pretty hard since 2013, I said, and then we're getting ready to meet one-on-one with employees in the next 2 to 3 weeks.
And to speak a little bit about your comment about employees fearing this, at ATSU, Dr. Phelps and all of us have been trying to minimize the impact to employees as much as possible. So what we've decided to do is anyone who is affected by this legislative change will maintain their full benefit package that they have currently. They will have to track their time. They will be paid overtime. So there's really, the downside is that you're tracking your time, but really there's more positive from that because you're either going to be working less hours or you're going to be getting paid more, because any hours that you work over 40 in a work week, Sunday through Saturday, you would be paid time and a half. So there's really great advantages available to employees who have been putting in exorbitant hours and not getting paid for those. So and to your point of, was that a huge jump? It absolutely was. Even whenever they made the salary change to $23,660, that was a huge jump too. The salary side of the Fair Labor Standards Act is what has not kept up with the times. So that's why they put that inflationary component into it this year.
Okay.
So certainly the double salaries, a lot of companies are very concerned of how they're going to cover that, or how they're going to, organize their staff in order to cover the new levels.
Right.
Okay. You know, it's interesting too, because going back to what Tonya was talking about, she mentioned a couple of things. So number one, you mentioned something about exempt versus non-exempt. Could you kind of go into detail about what you mean by that, Tonya?
Well, exempt employee in our world are considered salary. There's different criteria which the Fair Labor Standards Act allows you to be exempt, and there's five types of exemptions. There's an executive exemption, a professional exemption, an administrative exemption, computer, and outside sales. Those are the five exemptions in which an employee's job description falls under to make them exempt or salaried, as we talk a lot in our institution about. An hourly or non-exempt employee is the definition there. Someone that doesn't meet those criteria and therefore are paid overtime.
And so it's just exemption from overtime
pay.
That's
right.
Really,
I'm pretty proud of myself because it took me a long time to figure that out. Like, it literally means like you're exempt from the overtime requirements of the law.
Okay.
So the law does not protect those people who do qualify. Mm-hmm. They can work as many hours as necessary to get their job done.
Okay.
And we call them salary.
And we pay them a salary or a base, and we don't have to pay them any additional time.
Okay, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Now, the second thing I wanted to kind of a little more clarification on, Tonya, was you mentioned tests, some tests that you wanted to, or not necessarily wanted to, but tests that you had to, I guess, outline. Can you kind of just describe that a little bit?
Well, those are all on the Fair Labor Standards Act. There's five different criteria that you have to go through for each of those. And we actually are working with an outside consultant to help us go through and make those determinations. One of them is your impact or your decision-making ability on the business. So what decisions do you make that have a direct impact on business operations? So there's one there. It's all different kit for each type of exemptions. And we will have that up on our website probably by December, what all those are. But anybody can Google that on the Fair Labor Standards Act. And if someone wants to come in and talk about their job description with their supervisor, that's what we're here for. That's what we're to go over, all those different exemptions and criteria of their job description.
And I might add that the professional exemption takes in all of our teachers, so they are exempt from overtime. So as an educational institution, the bulk of our employees, which are faculty, those are all exempt from overtime, so they'll stay in our exempt or salaried classification.
Yeah, that's important to say. That's a lot of the people that work here.
Right, right.
Sorry about my ding. I left my computer volume on.
It's all good.
All right. That's helpful, I think. I hope. We've had several of these conversations.
Yeah.
We did a supervisor training recently, and I feel like we've been talking about it a lot, which is good, because it's, like we said, it's big changes that we're having to deal with, right?
Yeah, so. I think, like I said, change being the operative word, I think just because a lot of people are kind of uncertain about it, and that's where the scare is coming from. But thankfully, you know, these people here have kind of gotten the jump on it, like you said, been planning for since 2013. So I think as this goes on, we'll just have more clarity, and I think everything will be okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I think that actually is a pretty good time to call for break.
That's a lot of work.
That's pretty wordy, and it's a dense topic. But you know, I think we did okay.
I'm just not sure, but I think we might be exempt. So we gotta cut it off because they're not paying us anymore for any extra.
This is our lunch hour, right?
That's right. Yeah.
There is a creative exemption.
There should be.
So right now we're gonna go to our first commercial break, and in this commercial, basically the. The team in the back here gave Joe and I a camera to work with, and they said, "Hey, let's see what you guys can do." So,
there was a little bit of guidance.
There was some guidance, yeah, but then we took that guidance and we just kind of threw it to the wayside.
We did,
yeah, but still,
discarded.
It was a fun car ride, and we talked a little bit about the first episode of Lunch and Learn, and we're gonna go to it right now, I think. So we'll be right back.
Shall we talk about the first Lunch and Learn episode?
Well, okay, so you're new to the, like, Lunch and Learn thing now.
Yeah.
How'd you get roped into that anyway?
I don't know, it just sort of happened. Like,
did you miss the meeting where they
picked
the
person? Memo. Yeah. I didn't get the memo. It was one, well, actually, there were discussions about it for a little bit, and communication marketing. I think Academic Technologies reached out to, or ITS rather, reached out to CNM, to see what kind of involvement they'd want, if any. And we had our own internal discussions at CNM, and we just thought it'd be a good idea to kind of inform people and kind of go from there.
And you were at the internal discussion, though?
Yes.
Yeah, because I feel like every time I miss a meeting, I become president of something. So do you've done an episode now, right?
Yep.
Do you like it?
One episode, and I love it. It's great.
It's kind of it's kind of free flowing, right?
It really is. It really is. And I was a little bit concerned with how the first episode was going to go, just because I hadn't been a part of it before, obviously, and I've seen a couple episodes, but I was never really super invested in it to a point where you're working about where you're working through everything.
Right.
Right. So then when you're actually invested in it and you're contributing and you're doing all this other stuff, it kind of changes the game a bit.
Changes your perspective for sure.
Yeah.
Did you ever look up You saw Brian. So what I love about doing the show is how uncomfortable Brian gets when he realizes we're a little bit off script. I think his facial expression, you look up and
I
see
it. I didn't notice it, yeah.
When you, well, even at the start of the episode, because we didn't know when we were coming in.
Uh-huh.
Or like, and he's just kind of looking and staring and looking. I think it's great. You get him a little bit diverted, off topic.
And well, he's very regimented in that aspect. He wants to know what he's doing,
right?
Which is fine. I think you and I are more the type like, let's just see what happens.
You know, we surely can't mess it up too bad.
Yeah.
Right?
And it worked. It worked.
Right?
So, yeah. Can't really go wrong with it. But yeah, I think the first episode is great. I'm looking forward to more.
What is this supposed to be a commercial for?
I don't know, man. Like, so we did a mini, I see what you did there, and you did a little mini interview, and you tried to steer toward that way, but I don't know what Jean's going to cut up from this. I really don't.
No, I think it'd be funny if she would cut up some of the stuff where we say something like, okay, I don't really know what we're supposed to be doing.
Yeah. I really don't.
So I feel like if we drive around.
You know, it would be awesome if, like, we just had Jean somehow cut in, like, legit, like 5 to 6 seconds of just us not saying anything and just having it being really awkward.
Yeah. Jean's gonna kill us.
She's gonna hate this.
So you have 30 seconds to say something substantive.
But what are we gonna say?
Or not.
This is all of us. This isn't just a me thing. We're all invested in this in terms of what we're gonna say.
No, I know, but when you say we're all, I assume you mean like you and I.
Yes.
It's a little misleading.
You could just play some music and be obnoxious.
It's...
Oh, you know what we should do?
Copyright protected.
What else are we going to talk about in this commercial? Should we wrap it up?
Welp. Kit.
This is it. We're driving through the square.
We're almost there, so I guess this has been fun.
Yeah.
We should do it again or something?
I'd imagine we will. Yeah.
I think we will too.
Yeah.
Time!
Deuces!
See ya. Get throwing up peace signs. That's my favorite part.
I'm all about peace.
Yeah. Well, now we know that about you. Okay, so hey, we're back. Hopefully you enjoyed that at least half as much as Kit and I enjoyed making it. I doubt we'll ever get an assignment like that again. So that may be a standalone project.
I think they learned their lesson.
Yeah, right. They won't be so foolish next time. All right, so we're coming back. We still got Donna and Tonya, and we need to get Mary involved in this conversation. Before we do that, though, I wanted to make sure something that I intended to say at the beginning and I didn't. There are several avenues where you can watch this broadcast live right now, and also where you could pick it up later after it's recorded. We are live at live.atsu.edu. That's our live stream page. And anytime you see an email that comes across that says this event will be live, it's typically going to be on that site, and you can find it there. The great thing about that page is the recorded version of this session will show up almost immediately after the event ends. So if you wanted to watch it again, or if you missed it, or you weren't able to stay for the whole thing, you can do that. We're also streaming live on Facebook. I got to start over with my letters. its.atsu.edu/fb. If you were just to type that into your address bar, that'll take you to our live streaming page on Facebook. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's some advantages there. You don't have to create a different account. It just links to your current Facebook account. If you wanted to comment on the attractiveness of Kit or I or both together, that was the place where you'd be able to do that, and we'd be most comfortable with that.
I think so. Yeah.
Make sure you do the tagging thing. So when it says Joe is so attractive, like it actually tags me in the comment. That would be awesome. Thank you. My mom would really appreciate it, too.
Hashtags are welcome, yeah.
Hashtags are good, yeah. And then lastly, the high definition, sort of edited and cut up so that it looks ready for presentation version of this session will be available on our YouTube channel, its.atsu.edu/YT. We'll take you there. I don't believe we go live through YouTube, but the really good-looking recorded version of this will be there for all time or until YouTube folds. Doesn't look likely to happen anytime soon. So yeah. It's going to be up there for a while, and you can find it there. All right, let's get back into this conversation. And you and I were discussing sort of the follow-up questions that, so we know, we get it, FLSA, yeah. I feel like I sort of know what it is, what the changes have been recently, which explains why we've been talking about it so much. And we even talked a little bit about ATSU involvement and how we're affected by all that, right? But,
right.
But there's more to drill down to.
Yeah, definitely. And drilling down is the key. So I want to kind of get in the specifics a little bit, Donna, if you wouldn't mind. Mm-hmm. Just talking a little bit about benefits in particular, because I think that's another buzzword.
Yeah, I think that's one of the areas that employees have the most concern, because our benefit structures are different for our hourly and salaried or non-exempt, exempt employees.
Yeah, we're all educated. So, there you go.
So, again, Dr. Phelps and our leadership team has been very aware of that, and has made sure that in any of the planning that we've done, that we were going to keep that benefit package and grandfather those folks that are that we do have to move based on this new law. So we're going to keep all of that in place.
That's and huge,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So just clarify, I'm Joe. I was I had a salaried exempt position before, and my position's going to move to an hourly non-exempt position. Except you let what you're saying is you let me keep the benefits that I already had, even though I switch position types.
Right. So those individuals will be required to clock in and track their time, so that we can pay them the overtime if they do work over 40 in a work week. However, their benefits will stay intact. So they'll keep all of their pay time off and all of their benefits the same as they have right now.
Essentially, you just want to keep the transition as smooth and as easy as possible.
Right, right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So is that something the law makes you do?
No, no. There are a lot of ways different companies are handling this transition. This is just how we've chosen to try to think of the employee side and make sure there's as least interruption or
like disruption.
Negative,
yeah,
negative impact to the employee as possible. I think one of the most difficult things for employees who've always been in a salaried capacity to now have to track their time is just tracking all their time. So we're so used to, with our smartphones, checking our email after hours. We're used to sitting at our desk and maybe we work through lunch hour. That's all paid time now. So those are things that we're trying to make sure that we educate people and make sure that they understand that they need to track all of their time. And we've tried to discuss this with supervisors so that they're aware that they should not try to solicit time from hourly employees after hours as well. So all these things are should come into play as work is put out there for those employees. And that's part of the time and attendance, why we wanted to go ahead and go through the new time and attendance that Mary can speak to a little later better.
Yeah, I think Mary, that'd be great if you could provide some clarification, because like I said initially, I mean, we launched this week with regard to the new system. Can you kind of describe a little bit the changes that we've experienced now and what we're going to?
The difference now is that for the first time, we actually have a system that tracks your time. And so all hourly employees starting Sunday of this week were required to clock in and out as they worked, to clock in and out for their lunch breaks. So this will track legally what they've worked and what we owe them for. Mm-hmm. It is different. We expect people to have mistakes, to forget punches. We have a glitch in the system from yesterday that the in-and-out punches at lunch didn't work, so we're fixing them by hand. In payroll, we have Sarah Jones, Sarah Heimer, and myself, and we're glad to help any supervisor or employee fix their time cards. We do know that it's going to happen. But the biggest thing is you do have to go into the system, and you do have to clock in if you're paid hourly, or you won't be paid. So it is a very important thing to remember. If you've forgotten this week so far, contact us. We will get you in there. We will get any punches fixed that needs it. But we do know there's a lot of questions. Right now, the balances for vacation, sick, floating holidays are not correct. They should be up by Friday. We will send an email out. Employees that are exempt, which are salary, will be putting all their vacation requests in there also.
Oh, cool.
And
okay.
Their sick requests. Any of those will go through there. So they do need to be familiar with Emp Center, not just the hourly employees who are having to clock in and out.
Right.
getting rid of a lot of paper.
That will be great. Yeah. During this first during this first 2 week period, we're doing a parallel payroll. So we're asking everybody to send their paper time cards in just like they have been for this payroll, hopefully only.
Right.
That way we can get a good match. If somebody has forgotten, we can contact them to make sure they're on board for the next time. So, but yes, it will create a lot less paper additions, a lot less mistakes that are just adding time cards up. Mm-hmm. You know, this system is going to pull those hours in for us. We're going to be more compliant with the Department of Labor on actually paying everybody for the time that they work.
Yeah, talk about that. So I was thinking while you were talking, so it's probably more efficient, probably saves a lot of paper. Those are all good things. But are there other reasons why we feel like an electronic system is better? Is there something like legal that we're going for in putting the electronic system in?
There are some, because Department of Labor will tell you if you do not pay your non-exempt employees for every minute they work, you're out of compliance with them. I mean, that's a federal law.
Right.
So it's very important that we try to be as compliant as possible.
So being really precise, like exactly when you got here, exactly when you left.
Mm-hmm. And we do have supervisors giving us the schedules of their employees because there's a grace time to clock in and out on your first and last punches of the day and also your lunch hour. It doesn't mean you can't take an unscheduled lunch. It just means that grace period won't round that 5 minutes either way. Mm. But it does give us a way to make sure we're paying our employees correctly. It also follows through with some of the benefits. Even part-time employees in some states get sick time accrued per hour worked. And this is another way we need to track these.
Try to be really precise about it.
Which I'm not sure if everyone knows, but we're in how many states?
We're in 41 states right now.
So it really is a big job to keep track of all the state laws that we have to look at as well as the federal.
Yeah, I never would have thought of that.
Yes.
And they vary quite a bit.
They do. Every state has their laws that are completely different. We even have cities and states that can have a different law than their state law. And we have to follow, per federal rule, we have to follow whichever is the best for our employees. Whatever's going to be more beneficial, that's what we have to follow. So with the complexity of it all, just trying to remember, it just doesn't, it's just not a very good practice.
And this system helps
this
do that?
This system will track most things for us. It's like anything, it's not going to track everything.
Right.
But it is going to take a lot of the guesswork out of the compliance issues.
But it kind of keeps us from having to stay right on top of all of those legal changes.
Mm-hmm.
If we miss something, it was our, the university's liability.
Right.
Where, I think we've done a good job. I'm not saying that, but this will at least be a group that will tell us, okay, this regulation changed for this state or this city, and if nothing else, it'll just keep us from having to go back and fix things that we maybe missed initially or something.
Oh, sure, sure. What else? What are we not talking about? So you guys have been in the weeds of this for a while.
Yes. In fact, I started 18 months ago on searching for these systems. And
is there anything else that you're seeing? You said that we launched. What did we launch?
Well, just I think Monday was the first day we started actually using the new system.
Is that right?
It was Sunday.
Okay.
It was Sunday. We went go live.
So a few people have been using this already.
Yes.
And so have you run into any
a few glitches.
Yeah, but
nothing major so far.
That's cool.
Nothing that can't be fixed. We expect to find things as we go that we just haven't thought about because we do have a complex system.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of different accruals for benefits. And as of December 1st, we will have some of those switching because to keep those accruals for the people that are salary, that are going to be tracking time and be non-exempt, we had to set it up a little differently. They will be paid every 2 weeks, just like hourly are now, on the same schedule. Their benefits for vacation will be divided over 26 pay periods. It will still equal out to their 160 hours in the year. It will be, I believe it's 6.1555 every 2 weeks. Their medical time will be preloaded in a chunk, just like now on January 1st. But the vacation accrual will follow the 2-week schedule.
Okay. So now you said something that I think we've glossed over it a couple of times, and you always have to forgive me because I'm the slowest at this table and usually every table. We've got some people using it now. More people aren't using it yet that are gonna.
That's correct.
Right? In December, that's that December date you're talking about.
Yes, that's so, when the Fair Labor Standard Act
changes. Do I have to use a time, like am I gonna have to use a time clock?
Or a web clock. Employees that don't normally work at a computer mm-hmm. will have an actual time clock that hangs on the wall, and they're already using those.
Yeah.
So we do have departments that are using time clocks. Everybody else will use a web clock. We have an icon that was pushed down for Imp Center on the computer now. Mm-hmm. Okay. And it has a web clock, which is basically a computer time clock. It has your in for the day, it has out to lunch, in from lunch, out for the day. It has a transfer punch and department blocks that if you have more than one job, so you have a job in two different departments, mm-hmm. you need two different time cards. And it's going to let you choose. Otherwise, you just punch in and out.
Okay. That sounds pretty straightforward.
We tried to make it as user-friendly as we could.
So do all these people know who they are yet?
I think those are meetings that are going to be in the next couple weeks for the December 1st changes.
Well, Tonya and I have been working with the leadership team, and we've met with them, and we're starting to determine what of those positions would be affected. And once we get all of that, probably within the next couple of weeks, we'll be meeting individually with employees.
Oh, cool.
And setting down to answer any questions they may have and letting them know what it means to them.
Yeah, cool. So if I have questions about this, probably at this point there are a lot of people who haven't been notified that they're affected yet. Is that what I'm understanding?
Right.
But probably their supervisors know. You've done the supervisor training already?
Yeah, we've met with supervisor.
So I can just ask you, like, you're cool with me calling and not having a clue what's going on, and you'll walk me through step by step. Mm-hmm. Cool. What about you?
Well, I think one of the other questions I had personally was with regard to vacation requests. So I know it's kind of that's another hot topic. I mean, everyone wants their vacation. So for any requests made prior to the new system changing, or to the new system change, are we going to have to redo those requests again?
You will.
Okay.
Starting hopefully Friday, all the balances will be in there. Any request you've already made, you still need to put through the new system. Mm-hmm. You know it's going to be approved because it already has been. But that's the only way it will carry your balance correctly, and it will know at any time how much vacation or sick time you're going to have at any given month. So if you're planning a trip for next January, you'll be able to look on the system and know what balance you're going to have then.
Okay.
And so you will know if you have enough time. If you do not have the time or will not be having the time, it will not let you put in the request. Uh-huh. So it really helps the supervisors not have to go back and check constantly.
No kidding.
Because you won't get an employee's request if they don't have the time.
So this system kind of eliminates the request for paid time off that employees have had to fill out in the past. So they'll just be entering it. There'll be a schedule on the Imp Center that the supervisor will bring up, and they'll approve that once they approve the time, it will hit the calendar. They can see all of their employees and who's taking off time on various dates to make sure that they have adequate staffing before they approve requests. And so it should automate all of that and make it a little bit more easier to track all of the time of the entire department. So all of that will be done. Now if you, like Mary said, you can go back retroactive and correct it. So let's say, I think a lot of people in the meetings that we had were concerned about, well, what if I asked for the time off and they approved it and it's in the system and then I don't get to take that day off or that week off? You can go back in
as the employee, and if you have not, if the time is not passed, you can just go ahead and rescind that request. There's a little button that'll say cancel request. You just do that. It takes it right out of the system. It puts it right back in your bank. If it's already passed and you had, say, scheduled 3 days, you only got to take one. You forgot to change it at that time. You ask your supervisor to change it. They can go in and change it to the correct amount. So that way you always get your time right back, and anything even if it's already been submitted to me, I can change it at that time. So anything can be fixed. So we know there's going to be corrections, but yes, you can go in and cancel a request or change one.
So overall, it seems like a pretty simple process. I think it's just the fact that we're breaking the status quo in a sense that, you know, it's just hard for people to adjust to.
Well, and tough to anticipate every issue that's going to come up. But it sounds like you guys have done a really thorough job.
We've tried to, but with any new system, there's going to be a learning curve for employees and for us as the administrators of the system. Mm-hmm. So if anybody has a problem, all they have to do is contact us. We'll be glad to work with them. We'll figure it out if it's something we haven't thought of. But the biggest thing is change. And nobody really likes to have things change. And things have been the same old paper forms for a long time. So we do understand that it's new for everybody. But hopefully everybody will give it a chance. And I think after a couple weeks using it, everybody will realize it is pretty simple to use. And it will make their life a little easier.
Yeah, very good.
Nice.
Well, last words. Tonya, you've been quiet for a long time. Anything else that you wanted to add to this discussion?
Sure. I just want to say kudos to Mary and Barb Fitzgerald. They've been working really hard on this team, and Sarah. And just that, you know, if you have questions and you're on the Arizona campus or you're online or can't get a hold of them, Annabelle Bagara at 6266 or myself at 6007 can help you. Just feel free to reach out to us and we'll come to your desktop or, you know, come and help you whatever you need.
Yeah, very good. And I imagine the same goes for the Kirksville office. What is it, 2790?
2790. 2792 is my line. Mary's 2791.
And Sarah Jones is 2695 and, no, 2289. And Sarah Heimer is 2695.
Wow, that's impressive.
Having both Sarahs is
Kit, what's your phone number?
I don't even know my
own. Tell everybody your phone number right now.
It's 2539.
There we go. All right. Call Kit if all else fails. Call Kit.
Don't leave Joe out. He's 2113.
Rats. 2213, you'll get the Thompson Center. So.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, call Dan Martin. He surely knows. Yeah. Cool. So that was a good conversation. Hey, thanks for coming. Kit and I make it look like it's all fun and games and stuff, but it is a little bit nerve-wracking to sit here and not say anything ridiculous. As you can tell, I just gave up that fear a long time ago. It's made my whole life a lot easier. But it can be a little bit nerve-wracking. We appreciate you coming and spending the time. And you're going to stay here, at least. That would be weird if you left at this point because we're almost done.
Sure.
But we're going into the next segment.
Right?
Which is what, even? I don't even know.
Well, October is...
Is it me? Am I supposed to do the segue?
Well, yeah, but it's okay.
So
so we're going to segue.
Will you do it, please?
We're going to segue into this next commercial. This commercial. So October is Cybersecurity Month. So each October, ATSU partners with the National Association of Cybersecurity to bring you cyber safety tips. So we're going to break to it right now.
Cool. Your countdown was slow. I stood there and stared at the camera for at least 2 seconds. It was awesome. So there you go, Cybersecurity Month. You're probably going to be receiving updates from the departments that take care of our cyber securing over the course of this month. In fact, I think I just saw a phishing attempt notification today.
Yeah, I think so.
There was
yeah.
a new one. It was a scan image. Lunch hour close, yeah. So those things, man, people are always trying to get access to our system, and diligence is the key to that whole thing. And letting, I think our ITS department would say, more than anything, let them know. If you see anything suspicious, it's better to be safe than not. And forward emails and things that you might get that you're not sure of so that they can take a look at it and let the rest of us know to keep our system safe. Hey, so the next segment coming up is the next edition of our Get to Know with Kit and Joe. Now, this drive was with one of my closest friends, Rick Reeder. He offices right down the hallway from me. And so we go get coffee a lot and we hang out a lot. And so I didn't have as much trouble convincing him to actually get in the car. I think he was more concerned about what are you going to do when I get in the car with you. So anyway, Rick Reeder's the Vice President for Finance and Administration / CFO. He has a big job. He actually took over some of the duties from, you remember Mike McManus?
Yep.
When Dr. McManus retired, Rick took some of those responsibilities in terms of facilities. And so he's got his hands in a lot of things. Human resources is in his shop, the facilities department, all the controller and finance. So big job. And as with all of these, we feel like sometimes the president's staff go a little more invisible. they're involved in directing a lot of the major affairs in the university, but we don't actually see them or get to know who they are very much. And so that's why we're doing these things. And that's why we did this one with Rick. And it should be good. Let's watch it now. Hi, my name is Joe Vincent, and welcome to another edition of A Day in the Life. You're correct. Once again, I convinced one of our administrators at ATSU to get into a car with me while I'm driving. Anyway, before we go any further, this is Rick Reeder. He has a really long title, Vice President of Finance and Administration, and then there's a / CFO, which stands for Chief Financial Officer. So Rick is another one of our president's staff members that we just wanted to kind of take a few minutes chatting with. And so Rick, I appreciate you coming
sure.
out on a ride with me. All right, Rick, so let's start with, we know you have a super long title. There are very few president's staff members, which means all of you probably take on a lot of administrative responsibility. But before we get into all that, I would like to know like where you came from. Meaning education, where'd you go to school, what'd you do before this?
Okay, so I grew up in Kansas City, and with lots and lots of family in Kansas City. In fact, we have two sons, my wife Darlene and I. One lives in Los Angeles, he's our younger son.
Cool.
And one lives in Kansas City, and we have a new grandbaby just about 6 months ago.
Congratulations.
So we do make frequent trips to Kansas City. I was born and raised in Kansas City, went to Baker University for my undergraduate degree in business and music. There were two things that I did there. One was the arts, the other was to make sure that I could make a living. So my parents encouraged that.
Yeah, that was a good idea.
And then I went on, after I finished the degree there, to go on to Oklahoma City University and got my master's in music. Uh-huh. I was doing administration, was at a college, and also teaching voice. Uh-huh. So I got an opportunity to try both of those out.
Yeah.
And after a time, I decided I really liked administration. I felt that's where my gifts lie, and I decided to go into that full time at that institution. So later on, I got my MBA from Regent University, and so I've been now in a CFO role or a vice president role for most of my career, of my, this is my 31st year in higher education.
Wow.
And many of the schools that I worked at have been liberal arts colleges. So one of the things that really attracted me to Kirksville and to ATSU was the medical school aspect. And I really was attracted to the mission of ATSU, that we have that mission to the underserved population. It has a lot of strength in that it's just a really worthy cause.
Yeah.
So that really attracted me here when I saw the opening. And I also was challenged by the aspect of medical education and graduate school medical education. So I was really, really pleased to come to ATSU. I still am pleased.
So far, so good.
Yeah,
yeah, good.
I like the aspect of us having the multiple campuses.
Who all's under your umbrella?
Okay, so of course finance in our finance office.
And that's like the controller, probably what
right.
people would recognize.
Controller's office. Would have the business office functions. Would have cash receipting, accounts receivable, accounts payable. Lots of different things. Leases.
The whole purchasing department.
Purchasing, the audit. All of those things fall under the finance area.
Gotcha.
And then the human resources department, which is multifaceted here at ATSU, both on the Kirksville campus and the Arizona campus. And I've been over personnel for many, well, probably the whole 31 years of my career is human resources is a part of that.
You've had personnel. Yeah, this is probably a good time to disclose that you're actually my boss's boss. Right, so any misstep during this interview process could be catastrophic.
Well, you know, I have been accused of being bossy, so that...
I don't believe it.
Yes. So then the other area is facilities. So our physical plants, both here in Kirksville and the ones in Mesa, fall under my purview. So... again, it makes it very interesting, and there's a lot going on in facilities with the Kirksville campus, a lot of renovation. And then in Mesa, we have a number of things going with the new buildings. Well, they're not new to us, but we've been leasing them and we're going to own them, so that's exciting.
That is cool.
And a great, I think, business decision for the school every year.
Oh.
And so there are just a number of facets to the finance office. It is
with
the leases and contracts and all the things that go along with that.
So if I'm thinking about, I'm a person watching this guy, Rick Reeder, who maybe I see every now and then, but maybe not. I think a lot of people, your work can kind of just fly under the radar in that we know, we see the effects of it, or some of the departments that you oversee, but we never really know who this guy is, right?
Well, what we do is really service oriented. So our goal is to keep the university running smoothly in all these areas, finance, human resources, facilities, so that we can serve our students. I mean, that's what we're here for. That's what it's all about
right. When
it comes to education. So that's what we work really hard to do, and I have a lot of really good staff who work very hard to make sure that happens.
Mm-hmm. So if you could just spend a day doing the thing that's your favorite thing to do in your job, what would it be?
Yeah, it's tough to say because I really do enjoy all the aspects of my work. And I like working with people. I like helping people realize their goals and doing what they can do to the best of their ability. So
yeah. That's
really my goal as a supervisor. In all of the areas that I work in. So it's hard for me to identify any single area, and every day my job is varied. So I might spend more time in finance one day and more time in HR another day, facilities another day, etc. So it's it keeps things interesting.
Yeah, but I think you identified something there. You really enjoy building into new staff or the people that work under you and helping them figure out how to develop personally. That's a good leadership hallmark, I think. And I'm not just saying that because you're my boss.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, I say that to everybody.
Okay. Good to know. Good to know. I'll remember that.
Yes, please do. All right. Well, we got to wrap this up. We still have a little ways left to drive. I think we should go by Sonic, personally, but we'll figure that out. Rick Reeder, Vice President for Finance and Administration and the University's Chief Financial Officer. thank you for taking some time to visit with me, riding in the car. Let's see. Pumping the pretend brake every now and then. Did you pump the EMA? Not even once. No. Cool.
Yep. Well, thank you. And signing off.
Yeah. That's it for this edition of The Day in the Life. We're going to continue to talk to our president staff members, some of them more visible than others, but all of them perform critical functions for the university. And it's nice to be able to see their face, hear where they come from, hear what they do, and so on. So we'll continue to do this. But hopefully you've enjoyed it and maybe even learned something. I know I have. And so until next time, we appreciate your time. We'll talk to you again soon.
Segment.
You know, I do a good job.
Little embellishment there, yeah. But it's all good. It's all good. So, loaded show.
I know.
Yeah.
I'm exhausted. It's been almost an hour.
Yeah. Usually I'm pretty okay with hearing myself talk that long, but
this time it's like,
yeah. Whew. It was a little rough.
Well, hopefully it was worthwhile, I guess, right?
I think so. And I think for anyone who does want to rewatch this in case they missed anything or just wants more clarification, we have some options for you. So there's our YouTube page, which is, I think we could pull up. Well, let's start with our Facebook, actually.
How about so Facebook first?
Let's start with Facebook first. So our Facebook is its.atsu.edu/fb. So make sure you like us on Facebook there. And then the next one we'll have to actually go to is our YouTube page.
There.
See what I did
there. I see what you did there.
And that is its.atsu.edu/yt. So just insert that into your URL/address bar. And you'll go right to the YouTube page to watch some more high definition and see Joe and I in
HD.
HD.
That's good.
That's pretty good. So, outside of that, I mean, do you have any extra comments, Joe?
No, not really. I mean, the next episode's going to be, boy, in a couple weeks already. Yeah. Tuesday, October 18th. We'll be here at, it's still going to be daylight time. Will we fall back at any point? That extra hour of sleep is like, it's what I'm living for at this point.
I'm looking forward to it.
But it's not going to happen yet. We're still on daylight time for the next episode. So noon CDT, which means 10 a.m. out in Mountain Standard Time in the Arizona version. Those people that don't believe in daylight savings time, I don't trust them.
No, not at all.
That's going to be the next Lunch and Learn. And we've got a couple of interesting guests on. Kimberly Jones and Jennifer McNeely are going to come talk about accessibility. One of those.
Yes.
And also universal design for learning. I think it's one of those quickly advancing fields where they find new and better and different ways to deliver content and make it accessible to different kinds of people. So it's going to be an interesting conversation. I'm looking forward to having him on. Hopefully we get Brian back at some point. Everybody's going to watch this and go, this. The wheels just fell off.
Yeah, yeah. Without Brian, we're nothing, essentially.
We really are nothing.
Yeah.
You heard that Kit said that, right?
He's right there.
He's there. Yeah. He's right. That's right. Good. Literally right there. great. Cool. So that's it. That's all I got. So I guess thanks to you for spending your lunch hour or an hour with us, letting us indulge our fantasies of being on television news station or some sort of morning show or something.
Right.
We need coffee cups with our names on them.
Oh, that'd be pretty awesome. Except you could have one that says Kit and I'll have one that
says
Show.
I want the Kit cup for sure. Hey, we'll continue our bromance off camera. In the meantime, have a productive, great rest of your day. We appreciate you taking the time. Don't forget to check it out on the live stream page or YouTube after our broadcast ends. And we will look forward to seeing you next time on October 18th. Have a great afternoon.